Morning, Cubs.
Good morning.
We just had to do it twice, Jim. My name is Thais Renza. I'm one of the volunteer organizers. Raise your arm if you're organizer of the 1 Million Cubs. Yay! Thank you all for all your hard work. Raise your arm if this is your first time here. That is found and sponsored by the Kauffman Foundation out of Kansas City. There's over 180 other chapters that are meeting exactly the same time as us, 9 o'clock in the morning on Wednesdays. And it's just a chance for entrepreneurs to share their story. We are gonna have an awesome speaker today that I'm very excited to introduce to you guys. Her name is Emily Jones. She is the owner, founder of Women Making Waves. She's a partner of mine. I don't know how we found a way to partner. She's a partner of mine and also a friend. And she has an amazing story, and I can't wait for you guys to hear it. Come on, Emily.
And I couldn't really be in both places at once, I decided to get rid of the shoe store. So I still have a credit on eBay if anyone needs some eBay credit. I don't know what to do with it because I don't want an inventory store ever again. So anyway, after I did that and went through just being the, you know, the boss at both of these places, I was young. I wasn't really trained on how to be the right leader. So I got a little bit entitled, and I just wasn't becoming the person that I wanted to be. So I decided that I would leave the company that I was with and seek just a new start, a fresh start. So I was offered a position in Florida. I had never been anywhere except for Fort Myers in Florida. So, and I never lived away from home, which is Arizona, where all of my family lives. But it was an opportunity for me to change and be who I wanted to be, and I could be anyone I wanted to be. So I decided to take the job in Florida, which was in the same industry. It was home security, and it was the same salary, same position. So where could I go wrong? So I drove to Florida all by myself and got a little condo and started with this company. About 3 months into that, working for that company, they went under. And it was really hard because it wasn't my decision. It was something I couldn't control, which wasn't really something I experienced in my young adult life. So I decided to start my own, which was Cardinal Security Solutions, because I'm a Cardinals, Arizona Cardinals fan. So that was my bright idea. That didn't take long to fail either. And I had put all of my life savings, which was a lot at that point because I had worked for, you know, so long and so hard, into this business. And unfortunately, I lost it all very quickly. So that's when I really thought, okay, am I just good at home security, or am I good at business? Am I good with people? What am I truly good at, and what do I truly love? And the outdoors was really the answer, and it didn't really matter what I did outdoors. It just was just being outside, fishing, whether it was paddleboarding or kayaking or swimming or surfing or whatever. I wanted to do something that was outside. So I had, my stepmother had introduced me to paddleboarding in Arizona, and I was stubborn, so I never let her know that I really loved it, but I did really love it. And so I decided that I would start a paddleboard business. And it kind of sounds like it was on a whim, but that particular part of the business was, but having a business was not. So I was ready to finally give in to my parents' passion for me to be an entrepreneur like them, but I still wasn't ready to run their businesses. So I said, I want to have a paddleboard business, but now I have no money, no friends in the area, no network, and no equipment. So now what am I gonna do? So I decided to get a free Google phone number. I linked it to my cell phone. I got a very cheap GoDaddy website, and then I got a Constant Contact CRM account, which was also very cheap at the time. And then I started a Facebook and an Instagram account, which I wasn't a huge fan of, even though I grew up with Facebook. I mean, I've had MySpace since I was 11, and I'm only 30. So social media was my life from the time I was very young. So I knew how to use them, but I wasn't a huge fan of it. So I did that. I also bartended for cash at a smoking bar, which was like the last thing I wanted to do on this earth. But the cash was really good. I got to pick my hours, and I could work at night and still be in the sunshine all day long without being in an office job. And then I got a Groupon account, and then I told a few little white lies. So whenever people would call for my Google phone number, or they'd see me on Facebook or Instagram, and they'd say, well, I'm interested in your rentals, I would give them the whole spiel, and then I would tell them that I'm full. I don't have any available because our rentals are so popular. But really, I didn't own a paddleboard or kayak at the time. I just was trying to get to that point. So I just kept going with this idea and, you know, putting people into that CRM. So every time they call, I'd say, I need, you know, your phone number and your email, and next time I'll send you a coupon since I don't have anything available now. So that's what I did. I quickly learned that Groupon was, I'm sorry if any of you work for Groupon, but a ripoff. Oops, I need to go back. So it wasn't working for me, and rentals were not working for me. I wasn't making money offering rentals because I wasn't connecting with people. I was sending them out to, you know, out in the water, wondering if my equipment was going to come back, which I did obviously get some equipment because I bartended, I saved up, I bought Walmart kayaks, I finally met someone that had 5 paddle boards they weren't using, and I was like, hey, I can make money with those. So then Groupon, it just was like, you know, they take so much from you, and you're really not marketing anything except for the people that just want a really good deal. And those weren't who I really wanted to market to. So I decided to, and I had no friends at the time, still, no friends, you know, I'm not creating any relationships here. And so I decided to start a group called Women Making Waves. And that idea came up while drinking wine in a hot tub with the two somewhat friends I had at the time. I did have a little experience when I first moved to Florida where I thought I had a lot of friends, and this was the first time I had experienced that. It was like high school. And I was kind of like mean girled out of the group. I didn't make enough money in their group because they were all professionals. They didn't understand an entrepreneur. And so I experienced what it was like to be on the other end of being a mean girl. And I think it was a little bit of karma for being the mean girl at work, you know, to all the guys that I worked with at Envision Security. So I needed friends, and this was my way of doing it. So I started Women Making Waves, and I posted online on Facebook and Instagram. And I just said, I want to sit in a circle, I want to tell our stories, and I want to drink some wine. Does anyone want to sign up? And 3 women that didn't know me and didn't know each other all showed up to do this paddle. And I was super surprised, because when I posted that, the first thing I thought about was the rejection that I was going to get. Is anyone going to show up? I didn't have a system where they could sign up ahead of time. It was just kind of like, if you show up, then you pay me. And so I wasn't sure, and I showed up with my wine and my paddle boards, and these 3 women showed up, and I was just completely shocked and really happy. And then I thought, okay, well, maybe I should try it again next week. So I did, and the next week I had over 15 women show up, and I don't think any of these pictures of that, but this is what it looks like now. It has grown into something so much more that I could describe up here. Especially for the guys, you guys are probably a little bit like, is this really needed? But if you're a woman, then you know how much it is needed. And I didn't know how many other women felt like I did, or needed a voice, or needed just a friend, or for someone to say, I know exactly what you're going through. Because a lot of times in our lives, we feel completely alone because we're so wrapped up in what we're going through. So this group has become a family to me, a tribe, and it makes me emotional. So some of them are here today. It's so nice to see familiar faces and know that I'm supported through this. But there's a lot of growth that can happen with this group. I do have over 700 members, and I've actually personally paddled with all 700 plus of these women. So there's never been an event that I am not at where they don't see my face, where I'm not telling my story. I don't make it this long because they want to drink the wine, but I do tell it, and I try to share so that they're inspired no matter what part of their life they're in. So we have paddlers that are 21, because we're drinking wine, up into, I think, 78 is our oldest paddler, which is incredible. And there's never been a paddle where I've left feeling like I didn't gain something, and I don't think anyone that I know of has ever left one of these paddles and said, I don't ever want to do that again. It's pretty much you go, you enjoy it, and you leave with at least one friend or someone that inspired you to maybe change something in your life. So now to the business side of Women Making Waves. What I am really looking for in the growth is I don't want to lose the vision that I started with. I don't want to ostracize the members that I have now by growing so insane that, you know, that we're doing these paddles all over the place and that other people are showing their faces. Not that I don't want other people to help lead the tribe, but I just don't want these women to feel like they were guinea pigs and now they're not anything. So I do want to have a membership software. It's something that's really important to me. I don't know where to start with that. I have no idea where to get a membership software, who's going to be a good software. I don't know. So that's what I really am looking for in my business as it grows. I would like to offer, when I offer a membership to my members, something that's really important to me is that they're going to get perks for my business, but also perks for local businesses. I do partner like with Thais's business and other businesses in Ormond and Winter Park and New Smyrna, but I want to make sure that when it's kind of like, you know, your AAA car or whatever, whatever, yeah, AAA card. You go and you get discounts places, right? So I want that to be something that the women that are members are getting, some type of a discount, because these women are going to patronize businesses. They already do. If somebody sponsors something that we do, we talk about them nonstop, and people are buying from those businesses because of this huge group. So I want people to do that. I did do a survey with about 200 of our women, and I basically said, I want to offer a membership between $50 and $100. Do you think that's a fair price? And almost, I'd say about 90% of those women agreed that that would be a fair price for a yearly membership. But one of the things that they wanted was something they could pay monthly instead of a lump sum, because some couldn't afford that. So that gave me really the idea to do the membership, offer something to them, and know that I have a reoccurring revenue every year that's going to keep growing, that will allow me to do more for my members and with my members. I also, every single event, if there's a woman that cannot afford to go, I always pay for her to go. And although I'll probably continue to do that because I'm always giving as much as I can, I would love to have a local business every month or whatever, a week, that is interested in sponsoring one of these women. And not because she, you know, needs a handout, but because this event could change her life. And I think the women that don't come because of that fee, which is not very much, but if they can't come because of that $30 fee, then they probably really need to be there. And they might meet one woman, any woman there that might say, you know, that might change their life for good. You know, it might motivate them to say, I need to be here every month or every week, and so I'm going to work harder to make that $30 so I can be there. And I think that's really important. So some of the things that we do, we do paddleboard and kayak and we drink wine, which is amazing. But we also do a lot of other things. We're really involved with the community. We love to volunteer, and Surfers for Autism is something that I'm sure a lot of you have heard about. It is what I chose to sponsor this year. We're going to be doing 3 different events for them, and I have promised 25 of my female members as volunteers at the event. So. That's a big deal because 25 members or volunteers doesn't seem like a lot, but for them, they constantly have people that say they're going to be there and then they don't show up. And they have 200 kids in the water that are depending on these volunteers. So that's why we got involved with Surfer for Autism. This is my 3rd year sponsoring, my 1st year sponsoring without me paying out of pocket. And what I mean by that is my business did not always make money, and it barely does now. Money's coming in, but I'm spending it, growing it, or spending it, giving all the time. And so this year I decided to host little events in different places to raise money, and we did a raffle. So we had a lot of businesses, some people I see here, that donated for the raffles. And at our first one, we raised $1,000, $600 in raffle tickets, and a $400 donation after. So that allows us to sponsor 2 Surfers for Autism events without me paying out of pocket for it. So it's pretty cool that we can have these women come together and do something like that. And I did that in Palm Coast, which is not a market for me. So I know when I bring it down here to Ormond that it'll be a lot bigger. Legacy Housing is also something that I'm really passionate about in planning some events with them. They're also a local nonprofit. I'm not going to get into too much, but it's important because it does keep young women and young adults that are just out of foster care, gives them housing and teaches them life skills that they probably didn't learn while in foster or wherever they were. So really important, it really builds up these young girls and these young adults. And I'm gonna finish off by saying I put the Ellen Show up there because that is my goal this year. I would love to be on the Ellen Show. I'm gonna have to practice my speech a little bit better, but it's important to me because I would love to have the women be treated by Ellen. And what I mean by that is, if I could share the Women Making Waves story with Ellen, who's to me one of the most amazing women on the planet, then I think that I could share it with more women. You know, and if I reached 700 or 800 women here with just a little bit of Facebook and Instagram and word of mouth, then imagine what Ellen DeGeneres would do for Women Making Waves. And that's not about me making money, it is about my members and just showing them that they're important and showing other women everywhere that they're important. So. So I think that's it. Thank you, Matt.
Nice job.
Not on the water, I'm camping and I don't really meet a lot of people
that are trying to do business. They're just trying to play.
Right.
So yeah.
All right. Well, I love wine. You have to wait until after the interview.
Okay. Okay.
I'm doing wine until after the interview.
Well, we believe in you. Every once in a while I'll pay for an ad on Facebook, but it's pretty much word of mouth for getting my clients. And I don't know if you ever read The Purple Cow, but I call them my sneezers, and I treat my sneezers really well. So I try and offer things that give them free events. And one of the things I'd like to offer with the memberships is giving them credit for every time they refer someone, because some of these women bring five people every time, and they're new faces. So right now it's just mostly word of mouth, Facebook and Instagram. I'm kind of to the point where right now most of my events sell out, so I do a different paddle in a different place each time. So right now I'm in Winter Park, New Smyrna, and Ormond by the Sea, and all of those pretty much sell out every time, and I try to do one a month in each location. So I'm kind of like, if I market anywhere else right this second, I won't be ready for what's about to happen. So I did just purchase 10 or 11 new paddle boards. Jody helped me with that. So those will help me to offer more for more people, but I don't have any future plans yet on where I'm gonna go and how I'm gonna market past social media.
I'm Lori, local kayaker surfer also, and just wondering about whether or not at these different venues you have any guiding going on. Is it just about being social? Because, you know, I have lots of friends that let me go out with me. We already sort of have, you know, I understand connecting with the bigger community, but it might be a draw for some of them if you were providing a local guide at some of these places, who knows the river, who knows the ecology, to stand up on her paddleboard and talk about the solar eclipse, exciting.
We offer that with Paddle Florida now. So my co-ed business is all tours. So I don't just do rentals anymore. If you call me for a rental, I'm going to say no. If you call me for a group and you want to check out a new river or check out a new area, then I'm going to read everything I need to know about that place, and then I'm going to tour, guide you through that. So I do offer guide service for almost anywhere in Florida, like Wikiwachi. I do paddles there. I do a lot in Gainesville. I do Blue Springs, the chain of lakes in Winter Park. So I try to do just like that. For the women's group, I am guiding them the whole time. I do offer free lessons for paddleboard or kayak before the women's event for any of our women members, so that way some people don't show up and say, oh, I definitely cannot do that, because I think anyone can paddleboard, and the people that say, I can't paddleboard, those are the first people I want on a paddleboard, because I want them to leave there realizing that it is not as hard as it looks. It's not surfing, it's paddleboarding, and those boards are made for beginners, you know? So, it's a great idea. I think with Paddle Florida now, we're gonna just keep growing into offering better tours. It's really hard to find guides that want to do what I do. I don't have a brick and mortar store. I do everything from my truck and trailer. That's important to me because I wanna offer good prices. But I also, when I hire someone, they have to know how to drive a truck and trailer. So that has really been the hardest part in my growth of hiring people, because I would love to see someone offer a tour that's not me, that grew up, you know, in the Calalisa River, or grew up fishing in Mosquito Lagoon. You know, those are things that, yeah, I can read all I want about it, but some things I can't teach you. So I would love to have that and hopefully find someone that can drive my truck and trailer and not wreck it.
Definitely value added if you have an interesting tour.
Right. I am
like what does it happen there? And how about your competitors? What?
Okay. So for competitors, for this particular, for women making waves, I don't really have any that I know of. I do have competitors with paddle boarding now. I mean, there's paddle boarding Smyrna, there's Three Brothers. But I think what's special about what I do is just that I do offer personalized service. Like, I'm there for every paddle, and that's important to me. So there are competitors in paddle boarding now, but with women making waves on the water, there aren't competitors. In other aspects, I think there are with women groups. But I, even if there was another business like Women Making Waves on the water, I wouldn't consider it a competitor. I would consider, hopefully, them to be someone I could work with so that we could get more people on the water. For what to expect when you're at a Women Making Waves event, what we do when you first get to each location, so again, I do Winter Park, New Smyrna, and Ormond Beach right now, and all of them are river paddles or in a lake. And when you arrive, all of the stuff is unloaded and ready for you. I bring wine. I sample the wine. And then I ask the women to bring some snacks. And then we paddle out. We always paddle to an island. So if I can't get you to an island because of wind or whatever, then we basically go as far as the whole group can go. And then we anchor down. We tie up to each other, kind of like this picture here on the left. We could not get out to Chicken Island in New Smyrna. It was way too windy, so we went into Calalisa Creek. We anchored down, we tied up, and we just passed the bottles around. So, yeah, we don't get drunk, you guys. We just have a little bit of wine. And some snacks. So anyway, when you get out to the island, we sit in a circle, and it's kind of like a kindergarten class at first. We're all giggling. A lot of people are shy. There's a lot going on. People are coming alone, so it's nerve-wracking for people. It's sometimes nerve-wracking for me. But then we sit in a circle, and each person gives like a 30-second to 1-minute intro on who they are, where they come from. We have a rule about no drama. It doesn't mean that women can't share their story, or if they have something they need to get off their chest, they can't share it. It just means be realistic, and that there's no judgment. So if someone, you know, tells their story, another person should never and has never said anything rude to them. We're there to support each other. And over and over and over again, every time I hear one woman say, I thought I was the only one that felt like this, or I thought I was the only one going through this. The empty nesters, the divorcees, the women that don't know what they want to do with their lives, or that, you know, are retired, and they're like, now what do I do? So there's always one of those women there. And then when they leave there, they have friends. So we just go around that circle. We just drink a little bit of wine. We just talk about who we are and what we're going through and what we want to change. There are women that have come to this group and have the confidence to now lose 100 pounds. There are women that have come here and made friends that now they paddle with privately. So we do have a private Women Making Waves page, which is you can request to join it if you're a woman, and you can post in there if you want to go to happy hour, or maybe you want to go to church with somebody, maybe you have an extra paddleboard or kayak, or you're looking for one and you just want to go out with them. They don't charge. It's just, you know, you want to go out and do something different because maybe I'm not offering a paddle that day, or I can't go with you, and so they post that, and then they get to paddle with the group even outside of me. Volunteer work. There's women that sell stuff, that have their own businesses. They're allowed to market on that page. And it gives them an opportunity to be themselves outside of that circle.
Hey, Emily. Hi. Great presentation. Awesome job. You put up a big picture, life-changing goal that could reach millions and millions of women out there. So I want to know, like, what you're doing specifically to get Ellen's attention to pursue that Ellen DeGeneres Show goal.
Okay. Well, every Friday I wear my Ellen shirt, and I take a selfie with it, and I post it on our Instagram. That's what I'm doing first. And then I have, I've asked some of our women, not really asked, I basically have told our Women Making Waves members, this is where I want to be. When we did the dream boards, my whole dream board was a big picture of Ellen, in the middle, and they have since sent tons and tons of letters to Ellen. So that's, I'm really hoping to get her attention. But what I'm doing as a business and as a woman to get on there is just being myself and promoting Women Making Waves as not just wine. As much fun as that wine is, it really is something more. It's about volunteering, it's about being a community, and changing lives. And I know that that's what she does on a much bigger scale. So I'm hoping that she will notice it, and maybe she'll attend one of our camps.
I'll volunteer again.
Yeah, and Thais, yeah, so for our this camp that we just ended on Sunday, Thais and Gwen came with me on Wednesday. We froze our butts off. It was 30 degrees camping the first night, and then it warmed up dramatically, but they were huge helps. And so those camping trips are amazing, and that is a much larger version of Women Making Waves outdoors. It's a 3-day, 2-night getaway, yoga, painting, paddleboarding, kayaking, snorkeling, all of those things are included. We also offer glamping, which is really cool. So the women can, especially women that don't camp or never camped before, they just show up and everything's ready for them. They have a comforter, they have sheets, they have an air mattress, they have twinkly little lights, they have a toothbrush, like all the things that you need. So it's really fun to offer all those different things and know that it's a community.
So how much does that cost?
The camping trips cost around $250, and then if you add the glamping and you don't want to bring your own stuff, because for me, I love my tent, I want to bring my own tent. If you want to add the glamping, which is everything included, that is $350. And then that includes all of our meals, and I pride myself a lot in making sure I'm not cooking hamburgers and hot dogs. So I cook really good meals. I cook it all on a very large smoker, and even French toast on the smoker. So it's very important to me that it's a good and mostly healthy meal. I also provide all of the meals from the local farmer's market off of 100, and local produce or local meats from Florida Food Service, which is a family and operated, family-owned and operated business out of Gainesville. And I do all of these camping trips out of Jenny Springs, which is in High Springs near Gainesville. The reason for that is because they are privately owned, so you can't have alcohol, you can stay up late, people aren't harassing you because you're being loud. You know, it's a place to be an adult, and that's why I choose there. And I also have partnered with Jenny Springs, so the owner, just this last weekend, has offered to make us their exclusive camping provider for Jenny Springs, which is amazing, insane. So I'm really excited about that growth.
I actually don't have a question, but I just have to say, I've been on her paddle boards, and I saw her online, and I just have to tell you, everything she's saying is dead on. That's exactly what she does. I didn't know her, and one day I just was just said, I have to get out of my comfort zone, and I said I'm gonna go. I showed up. I didn't know anyone, and I have to tell you, I left there feeling so connected to everybody in the group. And I was just sort of in a transition period at the time, and it helped me to kind of jump to the next step. And for anybody who's just feeling that, I mean, you can show up. I just have to say, because you can sit there and say it, but to hear it, you can sit there and you can show up, and you will feel what she's saying. It was the best group I've probably ever been to.
Thank you, Donna. And I'm so happy you came. Donna works with Honest One Auto in Ormond, which if you've never been there, the way, I love it. The owner and his wife, they make you feel special. As a female, you know what it's like probably to walk into a place and feel like a complete idiot because they're like, oh, you need your blinker fluid changed, you know? And I did not have that experience there. And so we've even partnered with them to help out with their women's event. They do a women's thing where all these women get to come for free, and they teach you something about your vehicle, and you drink wine. So, so much fun! That was really great to connect. I'm so glad that you came and that you did step out of your comfort zone, and that you know you had that experience. That is exactly why I do what I do in wine here.
And I will make one of those camping trips because every time I see them, every weekend I have a commitment. Next time.
It's hard to be in business and play, right?
Yeah.
I understand.
professor, and I've been able to do a lot of sporting events that way. Have you considered that?
I have thought about it, but I have, that's as far as it's gone. I would like to get involved with TripAdvisor and also Airbnb. I keep hearing people say, like, I rent on Airbnb, but I don't know anything about their adventure part, but I use it, you know? So I don't right now, and I do use TripAdvisor for myself, but I'm not marketing. So I need to get on that.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I'll jump in real quick. I got one for you. So Emily, Michael did a great presentation today. I'm just really proud of everything that you've accomplished in such a short period of time. Talk to us a little bit about what it was like to transition from corporate America to entrepreneurship. You touched on it a lot that your family is a background of entrepreneurs, but you didn't really want to go that route. So what's it been like? I mean, other than the first business not going the way that you thought it was going to go, what are some of the lessons learned for the folks that are in the room that maybe are working and are thinking about going into entrepreneurship?
That's a really good question. Going from, so my parents own a furniture store, which is not fun if you've ever dusted 11,000 square feet of furniture. I know Thais probably has. Her parents do the same thing. Not fun, so that was really what I was running from, was dusting. And my mom and my stepdad have a small airplane pilot business where they teach people. And as fun as that sounds, I grew up doing that all the time. Flying, which is fun, but wasn't for me. And so going into corporate wasn't just about rebelling. It really was about being a leader for me in my own way and not, just working by myself. It was about having, a leadership role. But then being in it and being so young and not having really the proper training and then learning all of that on the fly was valuable. But when I left corporate and I said, okay, now I'm gonna do this on my own and I'm gonna be working alone and I'm losing that, I felt like I was losing that leadership role because I didn't have a team. I didn't have to do my hair, put makeup on, or wear heels anymore. So I felt like I was losing that part of my side or myself, but then once I got into entrepreneurship and really took it on full time, I realized that I could be a leader, but in the way I always wanted to be. And I was able to transition mostly because I didn't want to be that person anymore. I didn't want to be entitled. I didn't want to treat people badly because I could. And so I don't know if that really answered your question, but it was a hard transition because you also think when you're going to go from corporate to owning your own business that you're just gonna make money and you're gonna sit back and you're gonna go to the spa and people are gonna call you all the time and they're gonna wanna buy whatever you're selling. And that's never the case. If it is, good for you. But basically, I spend 40 hours plus a week doing my marketing and because I do it all myself. That's important to me. It's important that I know the name of every single person that books with me. And before I had the software I have now, I used to do it all through PayPal. So I had to talk to every person on the phone before they could book, and then I sent them an invoice, and then they paid the invoice, and I checked them off. So it was a leadership in a different way, and it also gave me a chance to work as hard as I wanted, but also see the benefits. And so the harder I work, the more money I make. If I'm not on Facebook for a weekend, I know I wasn't on Facebook for a weekend because I'm making less money, less people are booking. And then I get on there and I respond to the 55 comments about silly things that shouldn't even be asked. And do I like it? No. But then they're buying. So I think that is the difference, is knowing I'm working hard and I'm building my own dreams, and that's totally worth the transition. So it's not always beautiful. But once you transition and you get over yourself, then it's a lot easier to be who you are.
Yeah, it's a great answer. I'm sure you like the sandals more than the heels too.
Oh, I do. I do love it. That's why I actually, and I was gonna just wear my yoga pants and t-shirt because that's what I paddle in, but I thought that might not be appropriate today. But I was like, I'm not wearing heels, I'm wearing flip-flops. So this is as dressed up as I really get.
All right, Tyler Cobb Networks Inc., great job. This was awesome. Definitely, thank you.
doing a really good thing for this community, you know, as a whole, not only just for the women, which is nice. We'd love to see a successful business. What can we as a community do for you right now, besides going on Paddle Boarding?
That's a good question, too. I think if anyone in this room has any information on a software and membership programs, that is such a big thing for me right now. I think I've outgrown my own knowledge, and that's one of the things I really struggle with, is I always try to do everything on my own, and I don't have to do that because I have this community now. But I'm, you know, I just need someone that can say, try this or do this, or that develops. Maybe I have to, somebody has to develop the software for this. I don't know. I'm sure there's something out there, but who knows? And I think it would be really helpful if we had some local businesses or people that are willing to help us find local businesses that can help give discounts for our members when we do have a membership program, or even now. Because sometimes it's easier when it's not your business to ask for things. You know, when I go around, I'm like, I have a paddleboard business and we drink wine together. And we want you to give away free stuff. Like, that's not how
it's not where I'm advertising. Yeah, but if you say I have a community of women, including entrepreneurs, moms, etc., that you know have time and disposable income to go paddleboard around and drink,
it's a little bit better.
You know, would you like to have their time as well? then you probably would get tons of sponsors and partners that might give you a discount or want to double book, etc. So, but
we have had a hard time finding, like, so for these fundraisers that I get for Surfers for Autism, it's been a bit of a challenge to get people, restaurants that will let us come in, and I'm not asking for anything from them except for, can I have 50 of my women come and spend money there? And that's been an interesting challenge. I mean, if I think about, I used to have a restaurant, I don't want to get into that, but it didn't go well either.
I left that out for a reason.
If someone came to my restaurant and said, I want to bring 50 women that want to come and spend money, I would be like, what can we do for you? But I think I also just haven't talked to the right people. So I did not work with the Brown Dog, which is a beer and wine place in Palm Coast, which was amazing. And they offered all kinds of free things. So it's not about the free things. I just want a place where the women can come, know that, you know, they're helping on whatever we're doing our fundraiser for, and that they're having a good time and feel welcome. So that would be helpful as well.
Maybe you could offer them something like a few memberships for their employees.
Right.
That might be a step in the door. Say, like, I love eating here. I'd love to give a couple of your employees a free membership.
That's a great idea. That's a really great idea.
That works for LA Fitness.
Oh, okay.
Get your wives, get your your girlfriends, your sisters, your moms, your grandmas to join, because it is, it's way bigger than just one or two or 50 women. It's autistic children and women or young women that don't know how to clean a house or cook a meal or raise a family. So I think it's
Thank you. Round of applause.